Okay, so I hope everyone of you can see my screen. I guess that's the standard question every time when doing any conferences or Zoom or whatever stuff. So we are going to talk about TinyGoat today, and I'm really honored to be the first one to start to bring you into the topic. And I thought I'd just start right into with a demo time. So I want to introduce you to a little project, to a little home automation project I'm working on in my spare free time. So lately, not so much because there is no free time at all, but I'm still continuing to work on it. So what do we see here? We have a web app and some buttons in here. And when I click here, something starts to blink around me. If I click stop, it stops. When I turn it off, well, it's dark in here. Yeah, I turned on dark mode in my room so I can see the blinking and the lights. So what is it about? Let us go one step back. So we have this really nice user interface here with some kind of login screen. And if I enter some data, well, that's wrong. If I enter some correct data with a highly secured password, 1234, I can sign in. And in the background, I'm talking to some MQTT broker to be able to make things blink in here. So now you wonder, what is it? What is blinking and lighting in here? I have some LED strip right here, which is connected to a microcontroller. I currently can't move it, or the cables are going to fall off. So I'm just going to leave it there. So we have some interesting home automation projects. I just wanted to showcase it as a start, so you got to see something before everything crashes down and stops working now. So let's get back into it, and we go back to the to this project later on again. So my agenda: what is TinyGoat? Tell me about the features. How do you work with interfaces like GPIO, SPI, and so on? And we're also going to talk about WASM. So what exactly is TinyGoat? In easy words, it's Go for small places like microcontroller, and also Go for WebAssembly. And in some more words, it's a new compiler for Go, written in Go, that makes extensively use of the LLVM compiler toolchain to produce binaries which run on lots of devices. So let us get some numbers straight. So TinyGoat currently supports 62 microcontroller boards, which is huge. And the number is continuously going up. So it could also be that there are already new boards I have not seen yet. So the number is rising all the time. And also we have at least 65 devices like temperature sensors or ultrasonic distance sensors or devices like this LED strip supported. And also here the number is continuously growing. So when talking about Go and getting Go onto a microcontroller, we have a little problem. If you have ever tried to write a really simple Hello World program and then just checked the size of the binary, you see, well, we have a problem over there. So we have the easiest Hello World program I could imagine here. We're like four lines of code, just printing Hello World, nothing else. And when we compile it with Go, we have it results in about 1.2 megabytes of data. Just this one, this four lines of code, more than 1 megabyte of data. Okay, hardcore. When we compile it using our TinyGoat compiler toolchain, in this case, I used Linux as the Go OS. We only had a resulting binary of 0.04 megabytes. So you see, TinyGoat, we have really, really, really small binaries in the end, and that's a really huge factor when we want to go to microcontrollers. So let's talk about features. Well, Go has such a nice thing called Go routines, and I can tell you, Go routines are supported in TinyGoat. Nice. Channels. when working with Go routines, most of us also work with channels to synchronize some data or get some data from one Go routine to another Go routine or something like that. So channels are also supported. Well, so we have TinyGo supports a big subset of the Go language. It supports slices, channels, interfaces, Go routines, the defer keyword, and also garbage collection. So more or less, lots of Go is just also supported in TinyGo, and also WASM and WASI build targets are supported. And now the question, okay, when so many things are working, what is not working? Not to with TinyGo yet. This is caused by the fact that not the complete Go standard library is implemented in TinyGo. And some things had to be re-implemented from scratch, like reflection. And reflection is not yet completely implemented, which leads to some issues when trying to serialize or deserialize data, like JSON data. So more or less, lots of things that heavily rely on reflection might not yet work. But we can easily work around most of these issues. So now you might think, okay, I have somewhere in a drawer some spare microcontroller you have not used in the past 3 years, but now you know TinyGo and now you want to try it out. To find out if your microcontroller from your dusty drawer is supported, just go to tinygo.org and you are going to find a reference with a list of supported microcontrollers and also the level of support, like is SPI supported on my microcontroller, is ADC supported, and so on. How do you work with interfaces like GPIO, SPI, I2C, and all these interfaces which exist in the worlds of microcontrollers? Well, let's have a look at the Blinky example I stole from the TinyGo documentation. The Blinky, this program is doing the following. It has a simple main function. We initialize a pin, the pin D4, name it LED, configure it as an output pin, and then we just run in an endless loop and just set the output pin to low and high alternating and waiting half a second in between. This makes the LED blink. So, and you might recognize there's a machine package. Doesn't sound familiar? Exactly. The machine package only exists in TinyGo. So TinyGo has an advanced set of Go standard libraries. So if you want to talk to anything on your microcontroller, you can literally just import import the machine package, and you'll find all the things you need inside this machine package. So we skip that for now. Also, you might know the Go Playground. I have good news for you. If you don't have a microcontroller at hand and want to play around with some simple programs like the Blinky example I just have shown you, you can go visit play.tinygo.org and play around with the TinyGo Playground in the web. Easy. So, I want to start developing some home automation project or something like that in my free time, or some whatever microcontroller project. I have a microcontroller and some LEDs and sensors. Do I have to implement everything on my own now? The answer is, luckily, no. TinyGo got you covered. We've got an extensive repository with, I told you about 65 devices are currently supported in the drivers repository. There's a repository for Bluetooth support, a repository that helps you when you want to draw text using fonts on displays. We have the so-called tiny draw displays, which helps you to draw basic shapes on a display. There's a Bluetooth repository and so on. So no, you don't have to implement everything on your own, and you don't have to really search in the wilds of the internet for examples. For example, if you want to know how to use such an LED strip, well, you just visit a driver's repository and you'll find an example how to use such an LED strip. So TinyGo got you covered. Let's have a look at WebAssembly. So what's that? If you have not yet heard of WebAssembly. I have stolen the quote from WebAssembly.org. So WebAssembly is a binary instruction format for a stack-based virtual machine. WASM is designed as a portable compilation target for programming languages, enabling deployment on the web for client and server applications. Huh. Sounds complicated. Well, it's not that complicated. You could say WASM could be the future of web development and could also someday completely replace the need for JavaScript in the web. How's that? How's that working? So we can take Go code and compile it to this WebAssembly binary instruction format, and et voila, we can run it inside a browser. For example, so you can have your Go code, your whatever Rust code, and so on running in the browser using WebAssembly, which is really nice. So, and standard Go so already supports WebAssembly. Why should I use TinyGo for WebAssembly projects? Well, because the resulting binary size of TinyGo is much, much, much smaller than compared to if you compile it with the standard Go compiler. So again, a good argument is TinyGo provides really, really, really small binaries. And in the web, you need small binaries, else you have, well, huge page load times, and no one wants to wait for a website to appear. So let's go back to the home automation dashboard I'm building. So my goals are, I want to control LED strips, like turning off and on, change the color, let them animate something. I want to be able to turn on my coffee machine, for example. And maybe I also want to get the status of these thingies, and I don't want to stand up from couch, from bed, or from where I am right now. And also I don't have Siri, Alexa, Google, whatever. I don't have all these things, so, well, I'm just developing my own application. And as it runs in a browser, well, I can also just use my mobile phone. And when lying in the bed, I just pick up my mobile phone and, well, turn on my coffee machine. Sounds like a plan, I guess. So we are the architecture of itself. So that's me, that's a little guy there, sitting, laying in my bed, and open up a browser, visiting the URL for my WASM, for my WebAssembly application. And I have a file server running, which just throws out the HTML file and all other needed files. And then internally, this WebAssembly application is going to run inside of my browser. And the WASM app is going to do heavily chatter with an MQTT broker, which is more or less a service which allows you to send messages back and forth in both directions. If you have never heard of MQTT, it's a really nice messaging protocol. And also, I have a microcontroller, like the one controlling my LED strip over here, which also heavily chatters with this MQTT broker. So my microcontroller can send messages to the broker, which will then send a message to my WASM application, and vice versa. So it goes in both directions. Yep. So the file server is really an easy one. I have just a typical file server which plainly serves the files. So I just initialize a new file server, let it listen on port 8080, and well, if it sees that a WASM file is requested, well, I set a content type to WASM. If it sees that a CSS file is requested, I'm setting the content type to CSS and just serve the files. That's the complete web server for my WASM application. So what other interesting files do we see when we initially visit this WASM application? So let's go to there, reload it, and let's have a look what we can see here. Well, more or less, we are asking for some MQTT JavaScript file, for some CSS file, for a WASM exec JavaScript file, for a WASM JS file, and for another MQTT JS file, and also for our index HTML file. That's it. So we have some files in here. So what are they doing? My index.html file is pretty simple. I have more or less an empty body. It just holds a div with for some content. I'm using the ID later on to dynamically replace the content, and rel, I'm loading the JavaScript files and so on. So pretty clean, easy HTML file over here. Our WASM.js file has the role to initialize, to bootstrap our actual WASM application. So we're using this JavaScript to initialize our WebAssembly app and run it. So the WASM exec.js is pretty huge, so I only have a small part of it as an example. The WASM exec.js file holds more or less the complete implementation of the syscall.js API and maybe some additional stuff, but more or less that's it. So when you're calling some JavaScript functionality or whatever from inside your Go code, when you use the syscall.js APIs, your call is more or less going to land in one of these functions here. And the last interesting file is the WASM binary file, which, well, is not that easily human readable. The WASM file is more or less the compiled version of our WASM project. So this file here and all its dependencies compile to that gibberish. Okay, so how did I get to such more or less, from my point of view, a pretty nice, decent looking front end over here when serving only a nearly empty HTML file? Well, I wrote a small library which I called Tiny DOM, and Tiny DOM is compatible, is a DOM manipulation library which is compilable in Tiny Go. And well, that was my first thing. There are lots of DOM manipulation libraries, but not all of them are compilable in Tiny Go, so I just wrote my own. What does it do? It is basically a wrapper around the syscall.js API, because the syscall.js API does not have the prettiest API to use. I found it ugly, so I wrote my own wrapper to make it a little bit more pretty. And I also provide some custom types. Custom types like shortcuts to create form elements, images, input fields, and so on, and so on, and so on. So making my life easier when working in the wrap. How does a code look like to generate something? Well, let's have a look at this user input element. It's the one where I enter my username. All I have to do is create a new input. I set the autofocus to true, set an ID and a name, and the placeholder text. Done. Then I just have to append it onto the DOM, and nice, it's getting rendered. Also, how do we handle click events in here? Well, we have a button, for example, which needs a click event. Well, we just append a click event handler like here, call it on login, and when it is clicked, the event is catched by JavaScript, it is bubbled into our code because we registered an event handler there, and so our code is called from within JavaScript. And then, well, we're just fetching some values, checking if the username and password matches, and if they do, well, we are throwing an event to a channel. So you might wonder, well, or you might say, well, I don't want to create a complete front end in the code behind using such a library or the plain syscall.js library. Well, I have good news for you. You don't have to create everything from scratch again. There is a framework called Vugu. And also good news, Vugu also supports Tiny Go. So Vugu has React, Vue, whatever like-ish syntax and way of creating front ends. So if you have some experience with Vue, Angular, or React, and you want to create front ends in WebAssembly using Go, you might want to have a look at it, as it supports Tiny Go. But it is still very experimental, and also the Tiny Go support is still in a pretty early stage. So don't expect too much of it right now. So more or less, you should, if you are more or less now interested, and if you all other following great speakers after me are finished, you might want to get to know more about TinyGo. So don't forget to follow TinyGo on Twitter. Join the TinyGo channel on the Gopher Slack. Follow La Pipa TV on Twitch, which is Ron Evans, who is also here with us today. And, well, plainly, just visit the website of TinyGo. And keep in mind or note, I have encountered the TinyGo community to be extremely, and I really mean extremely helpful and nice to each other. So I had lots of dumb questions over the time. And I got a question and a really good answer to, I guess, all of my questions. So don't be afraid to ask. No one is biting in there. Maybe I'm biting, but that doesn't count. So just join the community, get in touch, and start working with TinyGo. So, and now is the time, you're more or less coming to an end, to do some advertisement for myself. So I wrote a book about TinyGo. It's called Creative DIY Microcontroller Projects with TinyGo and WebAssembly. And you can learn how to set up TinyGo and your IDE. You learn the basics of microcontroller development. You learn what GPIO, SPI, I2C, and so on is and how it works and how to use it. You learn how to write your own drivers. And you are also going to create WASM apps and microcontroller, which sends data over Wi-Fi and so on. And you can get it basically at every bookstore out there. Here's just a link to my repositories. I'm going to share the slides at the end of the day today. So if you need any of these links, don't be afraid. I'm going to share this stuff and then you can find the links. And also, yeah, a big thanks to test.mosquito.org for providing a free MQTT broker in the rep I'm often using when testing out stuff. So really nice from these guys. And more or less, I'm already done.